Welcome back, guys. Today we're going to talk about exploratory testing, what it is, how to use it, how to apply it to your current project, and I'm going to give you away a free checklist that you can follow and use if you're starting out or already experienced. This usually brings you great results around the product you're working on, and it's very, very interesting to see what it comes up with. Without further ado, let's jump into it and let's start off with what actually is exploratory testing. First, to establish this, we also have to mention ad hoc testing. So we have ad hoc testing and exploratory testing. Ad hoc testing is basically testing without any prior experience or tester's knowledge. Like, this is more for people just getting started. There's also no structure, no predefined test cases, no nothing. This is also sort of called monkey testing. And then there's exploratory testing, which is based off of person's knowledge and experience. And usually there is sort of a structured way on approaching the cases, right? So in summary, both of these cases are sort of random testing, which is either based off of experience or based off of what you can come up with without any experience, right? But also, both of these cases are very creative sort of ways in testing, and they both require you to think outside of the box and requires for you to do fast thinking or thinking along the way to come up with all of these scenarios, actually, to, you know, either reproduce issues or find different ways that client could be using your product, right? So yeah, both of these methods are creative methods, and software testing, I feel like it's like one of the most fun parts in to actually do. You just sort of create scenarios and you just go with it. So yeah, it's very creative, and I definitely love exploratory testing, especially around new functionality. Now let's jump into why is it actually so important. So it goes over very different aspects of the same functionality or the same functions, because the same functions can be tested in so many different ways, right? So here the tester can come up with different scenarios to cover, test the same function in many different ways as the client or the user would be as well. Then this also later on helps either create new test cases or testing techniques that can be used later on. So this has been very great in the past to be used to grow regression tests, especially specific tests that have been proven to be very critical parts of the app or product. Then it also sort of grows, and not sort of, actually it grows your experience and knowledge exponentially, because you're just trying out all of these scenarios that all of them sort of pile up. And then when you even go to a new project, you have all this knowledge already of what usually breaks and how it usually breaks. So right now, for example, I can say I go based off my knowledge a lot, and I already have sort of understanding what is probably gonna break if I do certain scenarios to certain fields or certain buttons. And yeah, this just sort of goes with experience and comes with doing more of it. And this definitely grows my skill, like grew my skills when I first started out, exponentially. And I definitely also like sort of the creative part of it. And yeah, the creative part is why I also love to continue using it. So now let's also talk about when is it actually better to be used? I would definitely advise anyone who's just started out a project not to read any documentation or know anything, like learn anything about it, and just start off with exploratory testing. And then also, if someone new is joining, start them off with exploratory testing, nothing else, because this way you get UI UX feedback and you get, you know, different scenarios based off either that, like the new person's knowledge or your person's knowledge that has never been maybe used here before in your, you know, new project. And then you can get all of this great feedback that you can use either, you know, to create bug tickets or create UI UX feedback improvements or wherever to help your project get overall better. Also, you may have different perspectives, which maybe for people who have been working on the project, you know, their eyes have already established that the product looks the way it looks. Maybe you come in and you feel like, no, this is not really convenient for the users, and there's better approaches that you've seen and can be implemented. So overall, this gives very, very great feedback on all of the sides. And yeah, you get to learn the app sort of in your way and then establish all of the structured sort of learning afterwards. Then this can also be used during regression tests. usually, though, this is done for, you know, functionality side, and this is very short sort of exploratory testing around the functions for a little bit out, like a little bit outside of the scope, not like all day sort of exploratory testing. But yeah, it's very great to be used, and over time it covers more and more scenarios as you go. So yeah, it really does usually give great feedback, and I even sometimes add it to my regression tests to do the exploratory step part. Then it also can be used around ticket validation. This usually also brings great scenarios and issues that can be uncovered just based or thanks to exploratory testing as well. So definitely you should be using it also in those scenarios. Last but not least, this should also be used around new functionality, because users can be having so many different scenarios. So you should be trying to cover as much as possible. And, you know, if you already have established some knowledge, you already sort of know what sort of way to go to. And also you should try to take a step back and think of the ways a user would be trying to use it to sort of establish on what direction you should be going with the testing. While I was also writing this, I was thinking like, there's also things that you should not be doing while doing exploratory testing, and I should possibly name them too, because it's very common and I sometimes still sort of catch myself doing these things. So number one is actually to like, don't go into a rabbit hole. It's very easy to be like done when you're sort of feel like you're very close to issue and you're about to find it and you're so close, or you feel like you found something and then an hour passes and there's still nothing. So it's very easy to be going into rabbit hole, which sort of ties in to have a time limit. Now, don't go into rabbit hole and have a time limit for your exploratory testing. For regression tests, this usually is like a 15 minute thing. For new functionality, this can go from 1 to 3 hours, depending on how huge the functionality is. And this time frame, you should cover the most as you can. Everything else sort of goes outside of the scope, because if you covered already the bases, that should be more than enough. But then also you should be remembering to focus on the critical functionality, not on the small stuff, right? You shouldn't be doing exploratory testing 4 hours around, you know, links and very tiny, tiny functionality, but on the main functionality of what the users would be using. If you try to avoid these three things, you should be good to go and have more time left and do more productive exploratory testing. And then as the last point is, I have a checklist that I created for you guys that you can use for your exploratory testing. And it's very broad, sort of around the basic functionalities usually of a product, so it can be adjusted. It's just what I would usually start with while starting a new project, no matter what it usually is. And then there's also sort of part two, where you have more specific tests, which I would execute later on when I have time, when I'm more established. And yeah, the more specific tests are like accessibility testing, localization testing, and asking random people for their feedback and Google reviews, all that stuff. This is sort of, the checklist is very similar to what I did in my previous project, like one of mine. I have mentioned this in my previous video. I had some free time, so I came up with different test plans. So I sort of implemented the same things in this checklist that you can follow. And these usually give great feedback over the product on, and also very different aspects of, yeah, the accessibility part, for example. Like these days it's very important and it should get covered much more, as well as the localization. And yeah, there's a lot of other things that you could be adding there, but this is sort of a broad checklist to follow and it's easily adjustable, and it's gonna be linked down below. You can have it, access it easily, follow it, and, you know, share some feedback maybe of your results when you try to run this. I would actually love to hear what you uncover, because I've used the same things in my previous projects when I had some time left for other things to be done. And yeah, this usually has given me great feedback. But yeah, guys, that is it for this video, and I hope you enjoy. See you in the next one.